Okay, we all need to mute, everybody.
Good morning, everyone. Are we on Zoom? The recording's on so the Zoom people can hear me? Yes, technicians, thumbs up. Okay, good morning to everybody on Zoom. Thank you.
Good morning.
Welcome to the first Sunday in Lent. And Mary, once again, you and your team, you know what? It's a good thing you had a boring week. Like you weren't doing anything, right? Taking down Valentine's, decorating the hall, putting up Lent here. It's gorgeous. Nice job, team. Looks
you
really
can
nice.
Speak it louder, I can't hear.
So not a whole lot on our plates this week, I don't think, but lots on the horizon. Grand Bend Place had another wonderful event happen on Friday night. I heard it was just great reviews. And of course, they have a second performance out for Three's Company. It's a Saturday afternoon and it's April the 24th. 27th. Okay. April the 27th, 2:30, and it's already half sold out. So if you want to go, you better get tickets right now. Jazz Vespers is coming up as well, and World Day of Prayer on March the 1st. Do we have any new folks? I know Ann Taylor. It's nice to see you out. You're not exactly new to us, but it's lovely to be here. I'll give you a little secret. I think she's here because it's Christina's birthday today, and they're going to celebrate later. So happy birthday, Christina. Any other celebrations to talk about?
Yes.
Oh, sorry, Lori.
I have it on good source that Wilma Harris will be 38 on the 22nd.
38? Congratulations, Wilma, on the 22nd. That's this week. Wow, good work. Yeah, congratulations. Any other celebration? I'm glad you're catching Zoom celebration. So the 14th, I think you would have read it on Charlines if you read Charlines, but how many people in this room bought a ticket or helped decorate or helped set up tables or helped make some food?
I think everybody.
Or in some capacity were involved with the 14th. Just put your hands up if you were involved. Yeah, that's why we were such a success. Yeah. And I can't thank the people in our community enough. We had a huge community response of even volunteerism, but there are six people. I'm going to get emotional because honestly, the success of this rests on these six people. And I'd like them to stand, please. Karen Etherington, Lois Gill, stand up, you guys. Lois Gill, Lori Hyatt, Mary McFadden, Debbie Proctor, and Christine. You guys made it happen. We sold 168 tickets and we made $3,000.
Wow.
And on Wednesday, I think if I would have asked anybody, are we ever going to do this again? They would have said, are you crazy? But by Thursday morning, because of the tremendous response we had there, there was such a will to, we'll take it to council and ask if they would be willing to let us take another crack at it. The one thing that was said to me, at least 75% of the second sitting were not members of our community of faith. And this was an opportunity for them to see in our bubble, or for us to expand our bubble, the Huron Shores bubble. And I think that's so important for community outreach. So awesome job, you guys.
Some of those.
Now I just have another moment of celebration. I think we can go to the next slide. Sorry, I have to be Roger. Lori, next slide. Oh, man. Moment of gratitude. This is a peanut gallery over here in the choir. We have so much to offer thanks for, and thanks to the search team, but thanks that we're able to decommission the search team. I think that's about as much as anything. I would invite The members to come up here as I call your name and stand in front where there's a microphone. There's a little speaker there for you. The first two people, however, Joanne Berry is on Zoom, and she's joining us from Yuma, Arizona. Thank you, Joanne, for everything you did with this crew. And Peter Challen is joining us from Fort Myers, Florida. And Peter, of course, was pivotal as well. Now, here in this room, Roger Hyatt, would you come forward, please? Mary McFadden, Steve Nor, the chair of our M&P committee, and Janice Sinker, chair of the search team. Right over there, guys. Yay, we get to celebrate you. Okay, so 1 Corinthians 12 verses 4 to 12 says, there are different gifts, but it is the same Spirit who gives them. Each one of us is given a gift by the Spirit to be used for the common good. I think that's even carrying heavy pans of lasagna, Roger, just saying. To the committee members, 3 years ago, each of you committed yourselves to a significant leadership task on behalf of the entire congregation. In recognition of the importance of your work, we pause to express our gratitude and to remind ourselves that you did not undertake this task alone. You were guided by the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, the prayerful support of the members of this church, and the assistance of the United Church of Christ through the Western Ontario Waterways region.
We who served on the search committee for Huron Shores United Church willingly and faithfully undertook the task of finding a new minister. We pledged with God's guidance and your prayers to be open to the leading of the Holy Spirit in all we did and how we decided.
We established a harmonious working relationship with our committee. We tried to be open and patient listeners to each other and to the congregation.
We tried to listen carefully to the hopes and the dreams in the development of a description of our church community and the style of pastoral leadership that we sought, and to maintain strict confidentiality in all we read, said, and heard, protecting both the privacy of each other and of potential candidates.
We reviewed all profiles with open minds and hearts, treating all candidates fairly and justly, seeking decisions not made by majority rule, but by the coming together of minds, hearts, and souls, in a consensus that would build a firm foundation for the effective future and mission and ministry of this church.
Next slide, please, Lori. Is there another slide? I think I would like the congregation together with, no, it's not. I'll say this on your behalf. As the faith family of Huron Shores United Church, we recognize all the work you have done, and we offer our thanks to each of you. May God bless you, bless our new minister, and bless all who serve the Lord in and through Huron Shores United Church. Then, with our thanks and excitement as we head into a new adventure together with God, I officially decommission this search committee. Woo! Thanks so much, guys. That's great. I know. That's it. We're not doing this again, Nancy. So I'm going to turn it over to Nancy, whose sermon is Hello, Darkness, My Old Friend. Part one, sunglasses at night. That's all I'm going to say. Good morning, everyone. The drive from Dashwood to here, fine. East of Dashwood, not so great. If you're heading that way, there was a lot of blowing and drifting snow and ice on the road, so be very careful. Before I got here, the travel advisory had been extended to 8:30 tonight because of snow squall warnings, so please be very careful and stay home today if you can. I'd invite you to stand and join me in the call to worship. These times, they are troubling. This journey, it is hard. We follow our faithful Lord, though we may feel like rebelling. It is God who sustains, not our own strength. We follow our faithful Lord, though we may feel like resigning. In God is our trust, our protection from harm. We follow our faithful Lord in the light and in darkness and rejoice. Our opening hymn is, O God, How We Have Wandered. If you're using the book, it's number 112. O God, How We Have Wandered. Okay, I think we're good now. It's the little cluster here. And let's join together in our prayer. Creator, sustainer, and savior, you lead us through the late winter wilderness of Lent. As we trudge through the stuff of our lives, show us, guide us, and remind us of your presence. Help us to see and praise you in and through our days as we walk toward the cross. Amen. Said to Steve, I think my Pentecostal roots are showing a bit. We praise God with all that we have, all that we are. And our call to worship is to give and to serve. And by giving our offering, that is what we do. We worship. Your offering will be received. Would you stand as we give our response? Abundant God, we offer you these gifts in gratitude for your steadfast presence in our lives. We pray that these resources will provide care to the suffering, food to the hungry, hope to the poor, and a spiritual presence to the needy. Amen. Please be seated.
Your scripture lesson this morning is from Isaiah chapter 45, verses 5 to 7. I am the Lord, there are no other. Apart from me, there is no God. I will strengthen you, though you have not acknowledged me, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, people may know there is none besides me. I am the Lord. And there are no other, the one forming light and creating darkness. I am the Lord who does all these. Second reading is from Psalm 139, verse 12. Even the darkness is not dark to you, Holy God, and the night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light are alike to you. The third reading is Acts 5, verses 12 and 13. The apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared to join them, even though they were highly regarded by the people. Thanks be to God for all these readings from Scripture.
I'm starting a series for Lent. Hello, darkness, my old friend. Thank you so much for the music. I'm sure you recognized it. And today is part one. I wear my sunglasses at night. Unfortunately, these are not prescription. As a rather paler-skinned individual, exposure to total sun is sometimes a logistical nightmare for me. What about my hat? Did I bring my hat? Did I remember to put on sunscreen, even knowing that all my clothes will soon be covered with zinc oxide? Basically, my summer colors are red and white. I find winter is much easier, with the light glancing and filtering through the thicker sky. And yes, I know that sunscreen is still advisable on ski slopes, and no, catapulting down a hill strapped to two boards is not my idea of a good time. but I still wear sunscreen. And while I love the sunshine that we've been seeing more and more of in these past couple weeks, finally, I want to talk about darkness during this season of Lent. And again, the theme is, hello, darkness, my old friend. Now, not everybody is comfortable with darkness. How do you feel about it? Any hesitancy in going down to the basement or walking on the street alone late at night? A bit? I think one of the most terrifying aspects of the dark is just how disorienting it can be. In complete darkness, even if we're sighted, even our own hands are sometimes beyond our perception. Have you ever been into one of those caves or rooms where they've turned off all the light and you can't even see your hand in front of your face? It's disorienting and more than a little bit scary. Darkness can also present directional challenges. Without a light source, we have no idea where to go, especially if we're in a new place or on an unfamiliar path. And I think that we can experience states of spiritual disorientation as well. Often, though not exclusively, it's sparked by some difficult moments in our lives when we feel that our prayers reach out into kind of a darkened void. When we feel frozen or afraid to move, in case we step into something that's more dangerous, more frightening, and we wonder if God hears us or is even in the dark with us. Here in the Northern Hemisphere, those darkened winter nights, they can sometimes reflect our spiritual state. When we can't see where to go on long nights, we cry to God, and those cries become even more urgent. We need our orientation. We need our Star of Bethlehem back. But the miracle is that God sees in the dark. Genesis happened in the dark. And if I can remember that, when I am in the dark, I try to give it a hug. Sounds funny, doesn't it? I open my arms and I let the darkness respond to my other senses. When I can't see, I need to feel. You might not think so, but there can be miracles and joy and peace and comfort and growing of our faith in darkness as well as in light. Sun and light and brightness, they all have their place, absolutely. And so does darkness and the coolness of the depths and the quiet moments when those night bloomers are opening. When the nights are longer and the stars and the moon take center stage, this time of Lent, this is not a season to be endured. I want us to see Lent as a season of blessing. That last reading that you heard. Now, Jesus's followers were going strong. They were telling everybody about Jesus and God's love and grace, and they were like beacons of light that was almost blinding in their enthusiasm and their dedication. But in today's reading, I actually feel kind of a kinship with the people who didn't dare join those apostles in Solomon's colonnade, which is a fancy word for porch. Listen again. The apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people, and all of the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade, but no one else dare joined them, even though they were highly regarded by the people. The apostles were performing amazing, dazzling, bright, glaring, unalloying wonders. And it was scaring people off. The Jesus movement struggled to grow because the apostles were all sunshine and no shade. They were all sunshine and no shade. When the sun is at its highest point in the day, Don't we all appreciate a little shade? Christ was nurtured in the darkness of Mary's womb. He was protected from Herod's wrath by the safety of night shadows. He was resurrected from the deep darkness of the tomb. We need to remember that darkness can also be a site of tender mercies and safety and respite. In John chapter 9, verse 4, Jesus said, "We must work the works of the one who sent me while it is day, because night is coming when no one can work." I can't help but think that surely he who was best friends with nocturnal fishermen knew that those words weren't completely right the moment they came out of his mouth, because God's work is done in the darkness all the time. Anybody else ever have trouble sleeping? Does it just happen, you know, when you get over 50? I don't know. I call my insomnia my alone time with God. It's a great time to pray. Honestly, I have to admit that I often have to apologize to God in the morning for nodding off in the middle of our conversation, though. But, you know, even in the middle of the night, God and I are not alone. Amidst the sleepiness of the 3 a.m. prayers, I remember all of the other people that are awake with me, and I don't just mean all of you insomniacs. I think of long-haul truckers moving food, new parents with midnight feedings and diaper changings, laborers making roads drivable, janitors making bathrooms fresh for a new day, ICU nurses checking patients' vitals, third shift factory workers with children sleeping at home, lovers making love and whatever else they're making, ministers fielding emergency phone calls, college students pulling all-nighters, and so many more. The work that is happening even in the dark. Night falls and God's people keep working. Senses sharpened by the dimness, pushing their way through, sometimes and often praying their way through. Sometimes we're called to be the skeleton crew in the dark work, in the dark times, to keep the supply chain going, the supplies of love and healing and support, even when things seem dark. There are times when our work is seen only by a few people, sometimes by nobody. And still we are commanded to keep on, sometimes in literal darkness, sometimes in figurative darkness, laboring for others and laboring for a future we can't yet know, but we are determined to keep the faith, to find in the darkness miracles and safety and respite. And so in time, we know God's light will shine, and shine brilliantly, brightly, gloriously through us. Yes, even through us, we who stumble in the dark, in order to move even our piece of the world towards wholeness and God's grace. That is what we are called to do. It is the people we are called to be, working in light and in dark. And then you see, when that happens, well, you better get those sunglasses ready. Let's pray together. God of light and love, we wait in the darkness expectantly, longingly, anxiously, and thoughtfully, because the darkness is our friend. In the darkness of the womb, we have been nurtured and protected. It is only in the darkness that we can see the splendor of your universe, that blanket of stars, the glowing of planets. In the darkness of sleep, we are soothed and restored, healed and renewed. And in the darkness of sleep, dreams rise up. Sometimes in the solitude of the darkness, our fears and concerns, our hopes and our visions, they all rise to the surface. We come face to face with ourselves and with the road that lies ahead of us. And in that same darkness, we find companionship for the journey with others and with you. In darkness, we sometimes allow ourselves to wonder and worry whether the human race is even going to survive, whether we are going to survive and make it to the next year or the next day or the next situation. And so we bring our fears and our concerns to you. We pray for those who feel that there is no light at all because of exhaustion or depression, because of illness or grief. Today, we remember Doug Proctor's brother Ken, having received a diagnosis of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. We pray that you will work with the doctors that are treating him so that they find a way to help encourage him and look after him and help him towards healing. We also pray for Charles McDonald and the family with Roz's passing. It will leave such a hole in their lives and in the lives of so many people. We are thankful for Roz and her life and her ministry and her care. And now we ask for your comfort to be with Charles and Rachel and the family. May we reach out to them in every opportunity that we can. We know that in the darkness that contains both our hopelessness and our hope, we know that you're with us, God. And we watch and wait for your peace and your strength, for you are with us in darkness and in light. You've promised to never leave us alone, and we know that you are a God of covenant and unbroken promises. So in the darkness and in the light, may we always trust you and praise you and offer you our thanks and our prayers, like the one we say together now. Our loving God in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the dominion, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Our closing hymn is Lead Kindly Light. If you're using the hymn books, it's 640. And I invite you to stand as we sing Lead Kindly Light together.
I am one. now go into the day and the week. Know that that kindly light leads us on, both when we can see that light and when we are in the dark. May God be with us, bless us, look after us, protect us, and guide us always. Amen.